Good evening, everyone. Pleasant good evening to those on live. Welcome to our third night of our revival. As we get started, turn to song number 1, 2, Alas and Did My Savior Bleed. Alas and Did My Savior Bleed, song number 12.
Alas and did my Savior bleed, and did my suffering die. Would he hold thy sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Thus might I have my blushing face, while is the cross a bear? Dissolve my heart in thankfulness, and melt mine eyes to tears at the cross, at the cross, at the cross, where I first and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can never repay the first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Alas, alas. first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the
way. Again, pleasant good evening to those here, pleasant good evening to those on live. But may I go to the morning prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for seeing us through this series of revival. We pray that we do things not in vain, but we will do things with purpose, and it will be all for growing your church. This is our prayer. We pray that you invite those who are on their way to get there quickly and safely. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Turn to song number 510 on Jordan Stormy Banks. Song number 510 on Jordan Stormy Banks.
On Jordan's stormy banks I sat and cast a wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land, where my possessions lie. We will rest, we will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen. So sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore. Signs won eternal day. There God the Son forever reigns and scatters night away. We will rest, we will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just a so sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore. When shall I reach that happy place and be my Father's face and in his bosom rest? We will rest, we will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen shore. Sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore. Fill with delight my raptured soul, who hear no longer stay. Though Jordan's ways around me roll, fearless I run to, we will rest, we will rest in the fair happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen. So sing a song of Moses and the Lamb by, and dwell with Jesus evermore.
Please stand as we sing Psalm 826. I'll be listening. If you're able, please stand and sing, I'll be listening, Psalm number 826.
When the Savior calls, I will answer. When he calls for me, I will.
Standing as we sing our song before we invite our revival leader for this evening, Psalm number 627, The Glory Land Way. Psalm number 627, The Glory Land Way.
I'm in the way, the bright and shining way. I'm in the glory land way. Saves today. I'm in the glory land. I'm in the glory land. I'm in the glory land. Glory land. Heaven is near and the way through it clear. For I'm in the glory land bring. Let's do the call, the gospel call today. Get in the glory land bring. Onward I go. the glory land, glory.
Let me say good evening to all of you for being here this evening. Those on Facebook, thank you very much for joining us on this our final night of our revival. Let me recognize Christelle's friend who is here with us again for the second night. Nice to have her with us. Candy's husband and Jai's father with us here today. Nice to have him also. Always happy to have all of you here from time to time. So we spoke about restore, then we spoke about redeem, and then we spoke about revive. And I'm going to speak tonight about renew. Renew. The text that we are using is Psalm chapter 51, verse 10 to 12. Psalm chapter 51, verse 10 to verse 12. Here's what David said. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Let's go to God in a word of prayer. Almighty God, we come before you. Lord, there are times that our spirit becomes mad. There are times that our spirit becomes discouraged. There are times that we ought to give up, or so we think. But Lord, you have always encouraged us to seek a renewed spirit so that we can get up and go again. We pray to God that this word tonight will fall on somebody's heart. Somebody who has gone astray and has left the path, that they will be able to be renewed and want to come back. Somebody who has never given their heart to God, but want and always thought about doing so, that tonight, dear Lord, they'll make that decision. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Renew. What does renew mean? Renew talks about to start back something that has been interrupted. To start it all over again. So when your driver's permit expires, and you go and renew your driver's permit, that renewal gives you back all the rights and privileges of that driver's permit that you had before. You brought it back to the way it was. When you renew your passport, your passport gives you all the powers and authority that it had before. Renewal means that I'm getting back what I had originally. Renew. It is making it new again. Want to see that R-E before word? It means you're doing something again. Resubmit. I submitted it before. I'm going to submit it again. Repeat. I have said something and I'm going to say it again. So that is it telling us tonight, renewing of the spirit is really saying, I'm going to have a new spirit because I had it before and I'm going to experience it now. So it is therefore, you know, when the Bible talked about creating me a clean heart, that original word is bara. Bara meaning to shape or fashion something by cutting it. shape or fashion something like cutting, something like the carpenter. Brother Joe Field is a carpenter. And when he's shaping something, he has to shape it by cutting off things that he doesn't need. If you're really a sculptor and you are using stone and you're going to, as one sculptor said, it's easy. The image was always in the stone. All I have to do is just get rid of all these parts of the stone that I don't need. And there inside of it was something that we need. So when we talk about renewing of our spirit, we are talking about shaping and fashioning the spirit in such a way that we get rid of all the things, cut off all the things that we really don't need. Sometimes our spirit gets also dirtied up. We get entangled with the things of the world. We have gone astray. We've done some things that we should not do. And have you ever gotten up and you felt as though you're far from God? As though your prayer not even going further than your rooftop? As though your relationship with God is lost? Renewal talks about, I want to get that back. And there are people who have always thought that I would love to have a relationship with God. Well, that is not a renewal. That is now getting it anew. But if you did have it and you lost it, we're talking about Bara, creating that once again. Listen to Psalm chapter 40. Psalm chapter 40, verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon the rock, and established my goings. And he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto God. Many may see it and fear and trust God. Let me explain what is happening here. The psalmist says, I am waiting for the Lord. And God is going to incline his ear. And the Bible says he heard my cry. This is literally what it means. That you cry unto God. God is not moved by your emotion. We think God is moved by our emotion. God is not moved by our emotion. He's moved by our cry. This cry is not one of the tears. It's calling out to God. And so if you are calling out to God, the Bible says you are calling out to God as a little child calling out to the parent. And the child calls out to the parent, Mommy, Daddy. The child is looking up because the parent is taller than the child. You cry out to God. This is what the Bible says. God inclines his ear. Now remember when he talked about Judas, they said he reclined. The one Jesus loved, he said, reclined backwards. But this is inclined. You call to God. And the Bible says, God leans towards, that is what the original word means. He leans towards you when you are crying. And when you cry out, he not only leans, but he bends over his ear towards you. And this is what it is saying here. I waited patiently on the Lord. Let me tell you, if you want God to listen to you, cry unto him. But wait. Patiently. There are a number of people crying for a number of things in their life. There are a number of people asking God for things in their life. But we're busy. Too busy for God. But the Bible says, those who wait, I will wait patiently unto the Lord. And once I cry unto God for whatever it is, God is already leaning towards you. So there are things that we need to cry for. But we cry for so many things. We cry for money. We cry for a job. We cry for shelter. We cry for everything else. But here's where the cry should be. We should cry to God for a new spirit. A spirit, because here's what. You can never get close to God if your spirit is not right with God. Tonight, we want to encourage people to make your heart right with God. And those who have been wondering if they can ever get right with God, I'm saying yes. And if you are a Christian, those who may have fallen away, those who may have gone astray, those who have become just viewers and passive persons with God. You know your heart isn't there. You know your heart wants to be here. You know that you want to be right with God, but you know so many things. We've gotten ourselves so tied up in so many things in the world. Then the Bible says, then cry unto God, and God is going to lean towards you. God will hear that cry. But you know, we complain so much. We run the tears so much, trying to move God with tears. We try to reach each other and move each other with tears. The more you cry, your wife cry and you feel so sorry for her and you're giving. Your children cry. We have told them that they couldn't have that meal or that they couldn't have that cookie or that cake because you don't want them to eat it this hour of the night. And the child cries and you say, oh, the child's so cute. How can I deny that child? And you do it based only on emotion. Not with God. God is not moved by the tears. God also recognizes tears, because tears is a language that God does understand. So sometimes we cry with the tears, but don't try to move God with your tears. Move God with your cry out to him. And it is because the children of Israel cried out to God. It didn't require tears. What does cry mean? You know, sometimes you're in a situation in life. Things bothering you, and you just don't have words. You ever get to that? That things bother you so much that the English language fails you to explain. Somebody asking what is wrong, and you just don't know how to tell them exactly how you feel. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. You don't have a language for that. But sometimes you get to a point that they tell yourself, boy, look at my life now. Look at how things have gotten. Lord, God, God, God said, I am going to hear that cry. A tear hasn't dropped from your eye, but you are calling out to God. And there are times that we need to learn to call out to God. Because God said, I will hear. Be patient while you wait. I have heard your cry. He brought me up out of an horrible pit. Let me tell you what this pit is. The original is a ball. A tight space. I don't know how many of you are claustrophobic, but have you ever been into a tight space? You can't turn around to come back out. You either have to reverse or go ahead straight. And sometimes you feel, as children, I've had sometimes when you, as a child, that the banister, we had that banister there, and I pushed my head through the banister. And because my head probably was shaped this way, it went through. But to come back out, it could not come back out. I was in a tight, tight space. And I was scared because I did not know what is going to happen now. I'll have to die here as a child with my head between these banisters. And it was concrete banisters. I'm telling you. But I felt scared. And the Bible says that it is in a horrible pit. That sometimes your life gets into such a tight space that you don't have wiggle room. Financially, you don't have wiggle room. Emotionally, you feel as though you are trapped. In love situation, you feel as though you can't go anywhere. We feel as though life is just closing in around us. He says sometimes we get to a point that we're in a horrible pit and a miry clay. You know what a miry clay is? A miry clay, sticky. Something that just sucks you. Clay. My family would remember that I had a recent encounter. I went to the somewhere way to the back of the house. It had rained, and I wanted to see where the water was passing. They had come and they dug out the center of a drain at the back and put all of the slush on the bank. And I went there to look at it, but I didn't tell them where I went. And I'm at the back there, and I'm in my boots and my overall. And as I went into the I stepped on the slush and my boots went right in. and started coming all the way. The more I stepped on it, the deeper I went. There was no bottom in this thing. So I took my other leg to get that leg out, and that went down inside. And that went down and covered the boots. The boot is up to my knee, and it has covered it. And I'm trying to pull my leg out of the miry clay. And as I'm pulling it out, you're hearing the suction, but the boot's not coming up because all the boots has this jut out there, and so it is not able to come through the slush. And I'm fighting to come out of it, and I can, but I'm going deeper in it until I fell over. And my hands went down. So I'm all fours inside of this thing, and I say, I need to call for help. But the cell phone is in my hand, down below the slush. Couldn't call anybody for no help. I know what it is like to be in miry clay. I know what it is like to feel helpless, as though there you can't come out of this situation that you're in. I couldn't make a call, and nobody knew where I was. I felt lost. Have you ever felt lost? Have you ever felt as though nobody could find you? Nobody could help you? You can't even get somebody to come to you? And I'm sitting there, and I'm pulling, I'm pushing. And the more I did it, the more I sunk. And I'm now in elbow deep and needy. The most I could do, I called upon God. I say, God, it's not a lovely sight to come and meet me dead in this position. I called upon God. I looked around. And this next part helped me. Here's what the Bible said. He set my feet upon a rock. I looked, and there was a rock at the side. So I had to try to now roll, pull my hand, got one hand out, and I held on to the rock. At least that was something solid. So I held on to the rock. It made sense. It made sense. When your life is going downhill, there are some people can't help you. They are just more mud, more miry clay. You need somebody that is rock solid. And the Bible says God is our rock. And when we have gone astray, we need to find our way back to God. We need to be able to hold on to God. He said, He set me, positioned you on top of this rock. He planted you on top of this rock. And he says, I have heard your voice, and I've set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. Boy, I tell you, I found that rock. I don't know how long I've been there, but I've been there for a while. I've been there a while. I know that I was there for a while. And I found the rock. I got one hand on it. I had to now pry the other hand out. And now I'm looking for another rock. The rocks were my salvation. And I pulled, and I felt the next rock. All my stomach full of mud. And I'm coming out of there, all my face in mud. And I'm struggling to come out of there. And I'm just looking for a dry land. Dry, dry land. Boy, I tell you, the struggle. But I was busy. If I wait long enough, I will come out. Wait on the Lord. That's one of the things about this thing. You wait on the Lord. He established your going, and he has put a new song in my mouth. We talking about renew? You see, the song that we had before was complaining. Oh, why me? Things so bad in my life. My life could never be good. Look at brother so-and-so. Brother so-and-so is this. Sister so-and-so is that. That's the song we sang. But let me tell you, when I came out of there, I was so grateful. I sang a new song. I was so happy. I mean, when I came into the house, I could see my wife's face still. Michael, what happened with you? They could hardly see me. Mud all over. But I was happy. I said, I still have a wife. I still have children. Wow. You know, see? The joy that comes. Let me tell you, when you have lost yourself in this world, and you have made yourself, and you made your way back home, you will rejoice. Because you will know what your miss outsider there, what you escaped outsider there. Let me tell you, the world has nothing left for you. The world is like miry clay. It's going to sink you. It's going to destroy you. It is only with joy and pleasures for a season. You don't gain anything outside of there. You see, when you come back home and you are on solid ground and you're back in relationship with God, you are going to rejoice. You're going to have a new song. And he said he gave me a new song. See it and fear and shall trust the Lord, because God is good and God has brought us out. So, here's what the Bible says. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. Somebody read that there for me. It's Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. Isaiah 40 and verse 31.
But those who wait on the Lord.
Those who wait on the Lord. This is one of the things about renewal. Some or the other, waiting is a good thing. Those who wait on the Lord
shall renew their strength.
There's a take your time with me, brother. Which means you had strength. You lost it. You will get it back. You will renew your strength. Go ahead.
They shall mount up with wings like eagles.
They shall mount up with wings like eagles. Hold on there. Let me just prosecute that just a bit. They will mount up like wings on wings like eagles. And they shall run, you said?
They shall run and not be weary.
Don't be weary. Go ahead.
They shall walk and not faint.
They shall walk and not faint. Let me tell you something about eagles. They say if you wait on the Lord, you will renew your strength. The strength you used to have. You know some of you all were strong in the Lord? You know some of you all were vibrant, energetic, love the Lord, couldn't help, want to do everything for the God, same day, every day, whole day. Yes? But you lost it. He says, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength, because they will get it back the way they had it. And you shall renew your strength. And the Bible says that when you renew your strength, you shall mount up like eagles, the wings as eagles. You know how long an eagle lives for? An eagle would live for 40 years. Listen to me. Follow me here now. For 40 years. That's a long time, you know. That's midlife crisis. 40 years. And here's what. At 40 years, the beak grows too long and bends over too much, so it cannot pick things. The claws grow too long and can no longer grasp prey. The feathers begin to stick together. At that rate, the eagle will soon die. Why, therefore, tell me that if I wait on the Lord, I will renew my strength and I will mount up on wings like eagles, when this is the demise of an eagle? Listen to me now. When the eagle hits 40 years and it can no longer hunt or eat, it has to do something to change that or die. Its strength is in its flight. Its strength is in its speed. Its strength is in its precision to prey. But it has now lost it. The researcher says that an eagle now goes to the rock. Look at where it goes, to the rock. Beats its beak against the rock to break off its existing beak, so that a new beak will come back. Are you following me? You shall renew your strength, but might take some battering, might take some licks, It might take some pressure, but if you wait on the Lord the right time, so it grows back a newbie. It takes this newbie and now plucks out the toes or the talons. Plucks it out. It takes 150 days to do this. It's a lot of painful thing. Plucks it out so that it can now grasp prey. Takes the new beak it has, pulls off its old feathers that are sticking together, and grows back new feathers. This eagle that lived for 40 years and does all of this in 150 days waiting patiently, now that it has back its new beak, its talons, and its feathers, lives another 30 years. It lives 70 years, the longest any of its species can ever live. 70 years, because at the point in time when it was dying, it renewed its strength, using 150 days to find it back and gets back in the air again and swoops down and catches all those things that said, the eagle is dead. We haven't seen him for a while. But now it's back, stronger than ever. I want to tell you that some of us have gotten weak. Some of us have gotten weary. Some of us have gotten discouraged. But you need to get back your strength to be able to live another couple of years in the Lord, to work for him and to rejoice in him. I tell you, we can do it. 70 years. But it needed 150 days to do that. Sometimes we have to take some time to get ourselves together. Hello? Sometimes it takes a while for us to sit down and talk to ourselves. Sometimes it takes a while coming to worship and hearing some sermons so that we'll be able to get ourselves together, such as over this couple days with the revival. Sometimes it takes us to be able to use a little time, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. That's what the Bible says. And then they'll mount up. Oh, when the eagle stretches its wings, it's 7 feet long. Brother Mike is 5 feet long. The eagle at all is bigger than the brother Mike. Stretches its wings. That is why the eagle doesn't need to flap and fight up its wings, because it's strong. It just needs to spread its wings and soar. And once it sees prey, it folds its wings and allow itself to plummet at top speed towards it. It's on rare occasion it misses its mark. Powerful, strong. That's what we need to be. That's how you and I need to be. And some of us are really too weak. Some of us are too feeble, frail, fickle. But God wants us to be strong, and God wants us to renew our strength. This tonight is a night for you to renew your strength. Tell yourself, I'm about to get rid of some feathers that keeping me back. I'm about to get rid of a beak that I can't eat anymore, because I haven't been able to eat properly out of God's word. You're reading the Bible, but it makes no sense. I'm going to change that now. I'm going to now be a different person for God. Tonight is going to be a change, so that I'll renew my strength and I'll be able to mount up like an eagle upon wings. That's what the Bible says. Now, am I making sense here, any people? No. I'm telling you. The Bible says, therefore, if we do that, we shall walk and not be weary. We shall run. And I tell you, we shall run and not be weary. What is it? Run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Long, long time. Let me tell you. If you want to be new, and you're not yet new, your first step is to be a new creature. Those of us who have become Christians, we can renew. But if you have never become a Christian, you can be new. The Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. Somebody read that there for me. 5 and verse 17. What does it say?
Therefore, is in Christ.
If anyone what?
Is in Christ.
Is in Christ.
He is a new creation.
That is how you get it. Because you are creation before, eh? But you are a new creation. Go ahead.
Old things have passed away.
Just like the old feathers. Go ahead.
Behold, all things have become
all
new.
All things become new. There's somebody here who can turn new tonight. Somebody online who can turn new tonight. Somebody who God has been calling and you've been absenting yourself from God. Ignoring the call for God from God. Tonight, you could be a new creature. You can be a new creature. But here's what happens. Some people are going to harden their heart. Some people will say, I want to, you know, but I wouldn't. Because the devil is going to talk to you. Some people are going to say, I want to change my life and I want to really get myself back in tune with God. I was there. Me and God had a good thing going and I don't know what happened. I messed up my life. I was in the miry clay. I was in all kind of tight spots in my life. Near death. I've been in some really bad spaces in my life. But I want to come back. But I don't know how. What people will say. People will say I'm not honest. People will say that I'm only doing this as a sham. Don't study that. Renew your strength. Don't harden your heart. Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 15. Here's what the Bible says. Today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. As in the day of provocation. Two voices will be talking to you today. Two voices. One voice saying, forget that short man. Yeah? And a lot of times, that is all we say. Forget the short man. But another voice is going to say, listen to God. God is talking. God is talking tonight. His word, the Bible says, will not return unto him void. But the Bible says, my spirit will not always strive with man. There's going to be a time that your shot will call. God is going to cut off your chance of return. Don't wait for that. Because when that happens, there's no repentance beyond the grave. There's no purgatory. There's no way of praying you back out. Once you have left here, you are gone. And let me tell you, life is short. Death is short. And Christ is your cure. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Is there anybody here today? Is there somebody here today who says, listen, I'm going to take the risk on God. I don't know if I could walk this Christian life. I don't know if I could live the Christian life. But I'm going to take the risk. Just as when you go to the supermarket and you buy something, you don't know if it was prepared properly and in a sanitary condition, but you take the risk. Take the risk on God. Make the move tonight and let God take you the rest of the way. There are brethren here going to be willing to walk alongside with you. I'm going to ask people to walk forward tonight. There might be somebody here who is a Christian, but strayed from God. I'm going to ask you, do you want to renew your strength? Come back to God tonight. Come back home. If you are on Facebook, post it on Facebook and say, I want to renew my strength. I want to recommit to God. Recommitment is something that we have to do every day of our lives. Because let me tell you, it's easy for the devil to move aside with us. Are you ready?